How's it going? My name is Scott Moss and welcome to Headless CMSs with Next.js. I've been building Headless CMSs from scratch and incorporating them in production with applications like Next.js for a very long time. And along the way, I've learned so many things that I would love to share with you in this course. We're going to be covering things like creating a content model that defines the shape of your content, how to create draft content and apply that to preview deploys with Next.js. By the end of the course, you'll feel confident picking a Headless CMS of your choice and integrating it with Next.js in production. Here in my GraphQL fetcher function call, I pass in my object, pass in my query. So we can pass in a generic here. We don't really have a type right now, so let's go make one. And this is where it gets really easy. So all we have to do, really, if you just copy like everything in here underneath the query. And what I like to do is on the root, I like to make a file called types. And I'll export a type. So I'll say type hero query. And I'll set it equal to an object like this. I'll just paste that query in there. Then I'll just fix it. So that's an object type. This is an array of objects. So I'll go down here and put an array here. This is a string. This is a string. This is a string. This is an object type. This is an array of objects. And this is a string. And this is a string. There we go. That's my type. All right, so now we have our types. I can go back to our queries. Instead of passing any, I can do hero query like that. And now this data is type checked. All right, so if I were to say data.heroCollection.items, which is an array, so I can say give me the thing in there, dot pre-title, it's type checked. It's great. It's beautiful, okay? So now we'll just say if not data, you know, we want to throw some error here. We're not handling errors right now, but oops. And then I'll just return the data. No, all right. Well, let's add this to our hero then. So let's go to our hero. Well, we might run into some Next.js problems. I hope we do so we can solve them, because I think there's one issue that we'll run into that's quite interesting. So we are in a server component because there is no use client at the top. So that means we can make this async like this, and we can just call our function, our query in here. So I can say data equals await get hero, or what did I call it? Oh, get content for hero. Get content for hero, like this. Now we have our data. But because that's going to return a list of heroes, even though I only have one hero, I'm just going to kind of scope it. So I'm going to say content equals data dot hero collection dot items zero. So that'll actually be the hero right there. So now we have that. Yes, this is, you know, you probably don't want to go around assuming you're always going to have stuff in here. So you want to make sure that there's checks and things involved like that, especially when there's other people modifying data on a system not connected to this. But for now, we're just going to assume that it works. And then as you can see, we still got the type check. So got a call to actions. We got our pre-title, subtitle, title. So now we're going to go out here and just replace these strings. So for this one, this is our pre-title. API Studio is now in beta. Nah, this is now content.pre-title. And API security framework, nope. This is content.title. All of this stuff right here, this is now content.subtitle. Let's start with that. We'll come back to the buttons in a second. As you can see, now my content is here dynamically from the page. Whoa, it's magic. Let's work on adding some content to the page in which we can control the order. So there's many different places in which we can do that. One really cool place is down here on the spots issues faster feature section, where you can see you can do this carousel type thing. That's pretty cool. We could do it there. Another way is really just like the links up top. I think it's just probably useful to be able to control these links and create these nav bars that you can pass around. So let's try that. So let's try to create these links up top. We'll create a nav bar, try to move those around, and we'll go from there. So here we go. I have navigation, the navigation collection. I'm gonna say, find me a navigation where the name and an exact match on the name. So I'm gonna do that. I don't know what this title thing is. Get rid of that. That's from the last one. And then I want to get the items, of course, and I want to get the name, but specifically I want to get the links. That's the important part. Get the items of that, and then get the label and the link. So if I run that and then put a name here of header, there we go. Get our navigation header, get our links and the labels, good to go. Let's go ahead and copy this. Gonna head over to our queries file. Make a new query. Get content for header nav. Okay, got my query here. I'll paste this in. There we go. Oh, one more. There we go. So we got that. Make a call to our little helper function. I'm just gonna just copy this since it's pretty much the same everywhere, just the types are different. So we'll do that. We'll go make a new type. Obviously that's not gonna work. Our variables are going to be name, and the value is gonna be header. At least that's what I called mine. Yours might be different. And then I just need to go make a new type. That's not gonna work here. So I'm gonna grab this. Go to my types, make a new one, export type. This will be header nav query. Okay. This is an object type. This is an object of arrays. This is a string. This is an object. This is an object of arrays. This is a string, and this is a string. There we go. Got our header nav query. Gonna bring that in from our types import and just put that down here. There we go. Now we are good to go. Got the same thing that we had in Apollo. All right, so now what we need to do is, this is a server component, so we should be able to run an async function here. So we'll say data equals await. Get content for header nav. And so let's actually scope this down. So content equals data dot navigation collection dot items. Grab the first one. That's what we want. And really we just want the links. So I'm just gonna say, give me the links. This will be links collection dot items. That's what I want. I want the links. Cool, now I got the links. I'm gonna just keep just this one and get rid of all the other ones. So I command X that, so it's in my paste bin or my copy buffer. But yeah, just need one. Put this one back. and oops, let me do this. So links.map, get a link, and then we put that in there. Link.label, link.link, link.label. All right, we did that. Now let's check to see if this is working the way we thought it was. So what we'll do is we'll go to our CMS, and we have about integrations, pricing, customers, change log. Is that the order that we see there? About integrations, pricing, it is. Okay, let's change the order. And let's see what happens. If I want to put about down here, I hit publish changes. I go back to here. I do a hard refresh. And yep, about is over here now. So that's how you can move things around the page. You can sort them in any order you want. If you want to give that person the power to do that, that's how you would do it. Okay, so the other thing is caching. Okay, so if I go publish a change and then I want to see that change reflected in production immediately, I won't, because Next.js is going to cache it by default. So you need a way to break that cache. There are basically two ways to do it. One way we can't really demonstrate here without setting up a tunnel. I looked, there was no easy way to set up a free tunnel that wasn't going to have people doing things that they probably don't know how to do. So we're not going to do the tunnel. But the other way we can do, and that's just going to be setting a revalidation interval in which we want at most the content to be revalidated. And we could do that because Next.js hijacked. So if we go to our fetch file, Next.js hijacked the fetch function, and they have a new property here called next. And I can say revalidate like this, or I'm sorry, tags like this. And you can pass in an array of tags, which are basically, you can think of them as like cache keys, in which this query is going to be cached, so then you can revalidate later, right? So for here, that just means I need to add in another property up here in this argument. So I'll say tags, and I'll make that an array of strings like that, tags, there we go. So you can pass in some tags. That'll go here. And then for revalidate, you can put in any number of seconds, not milliseconds, but seconds, how long you want before this fetch call to be reran, basically. So this will allow us, so basically if you're like, I want, you can think of it as polling. That's the best way I can describe it. It's like, okay, every 25 seconds, run this function again. And if there's been new data, new content that was published in those 25 seconds, that's what's going to show up on the screen. When you go back to it, it's not just going to pop up. You have to, it's when you render the page again, it'll show. Right, so let's check it out. I'll put one for 10 seconds. So I'll say revalidate for 10 seconds for every single one of these, right? And then just to show you how this works, I'll go into the CMS. Data is live. I'll publish that. I think that's what was already there unpublished. I'm just going to say new change. Before I hit that, let's just go back to the site. Let's just clear the cache, refresh, make sure it still says beta is live, no cache. Okay, we're good. All right, now if I go back here, I publish these changes. Cool. And then if I go and go back here, how long did I put the thing on? For 1 second? 10 seconds. Okay, so 10 seconds. Let's wait for a little bit. So now I don't have to do a, before what I would have to have done to see the latest on this published was to do a hard refresh. But I have to do a command shift R just to see the changes. But now after 10 seconds, if I just do a command R, I guess 10 seconds hasn't passed yet. There it is. There's a new change, right? So it revalidated that after 10 seconds. So when the next person goes to that site after 10 seconds, you'll see it. Whereas before, it's basically cached indefinitely. And the only way to see it is like if you, in this case on development, do a hard refresh.